Well, I know you want to tell, and we're going to show a video later, but I know you want to tell us a little bit about that video and a little bit about the story before we kind of go back to where it all started. Thank you.
Well, first of all, I'm delighted to be here, and as an avid library user, I thank you all for all the great work you do. And Marin County, I thank you specifically, and if there's anybody here from Mill Valley, you do a great job. We're going to talk a little bit how I got into the world I'm in now, this whole second career. But I was awarded this for a program I started in 2000, which was called Farm to Family, and it's to glean and collect fresh fruits and vegetables and redistribute them to people in need. And we started just in Northern California, and now we're statewide. And as I say, we started in 2000, and we distributed about 750,000 pounds of stone fruit, peaches, plums, and nectarines. And by 2008, and just talks to the strength of what food banks can do, we distributed 63 million pounds of fresh fruits and vegetables, and it equates out to about every week about 500,000 Californians in need are receiving this product completely free through about 40 food banks throughout the state. So it's just, to me, and I'd love to take all the credit, but absolutely not. We've got a great team of people, and it's a program that's right for this time. And of course, with this economic situation, the value of being able to give nutritious food, the whole obesity issue, to be able to give and give nutritious food to people in need is just very, very exciting to be part of it. So with that, I'll turn it back over to Steve.
Well, you started, you had a career, you had your own business in the food industry. Tell us about that transition from that career to what preceded Farm to Family.
Okay, yeah, I believe there's a time in one's life when it's right to give back. And we all have different points of when that happens. For me, was when my first wife passed away. And it was 1993, and my children were basically grown, and I'm thinking, okay, what am I gonna do for the rest of my life? And when we came over, I'm from London, and when we first came over as immigrants, the Peace Corps just started, and I thought that was just a great opportunity, but it wasn't in the cards. My wife just arrived. Thank you. I forgot the DVD, left it at home, she went back and got it. But it wasn't right. It wasn't right. We're going to have a family, etc., etc. So you move on the clock to 1993, and what the Peace Corps said. I talked to my children and said, you know, I'm going to give back, and I think I'm going to join the Peace Corps. And what do you think? And I think their first thought was, well, there goes the inheritance, you know? Yeah. So went through a whole process of applying to the Peace Corps. And then as time goes on, and as I say, I had a company, but I didn't want to tell anybody I was doing it. So I was really my only source of consultation with my children. And they were very encouraging. And after a period of time, I decided, no, the Peace Corps is not the thing. I want to do VISTA, the Domestic Peace Corps. I don't have to leave my home. But I don't want to do anything with the food industry. I've been working my whole career just doing food, selling food, merchandising food, marketing food. And that's obviously was the wrong decision. So little by little, it kind of all fell into place, and my middle daughter was graduating with a master's from Mills, and we planned it so that we'd go to Europe, I'd come back and start a career in food banking, and that's when I joined San Francisco Food Bank in 1994.
So you started with the food bank, and what were some of the things that you did? in that work?
Well, we had a 10,000 square foot building. It leaked like a sieve. We had no bathrooms, and we're moving about. We're distributing about 3 million pounds of food in the city and county of San Francisco. And the first thing I saw was that the need for collaboration. There's about 40 food banks throughout the state. And they're all doing their own thing and not working together. And I saw the need and realized the value of collaboration. So that's really what I worked on for the first 6 years, as far as bringing in food to San Francisco, working with other food banks, helping other food banks. I joined through Vista, as I mentioned, and that's a one-year commitment. The end of 1 year, I thought, well, maybe I just go back and do what I was doing before. But you know, the thing that I really gave myself and I've kept is all these years is I value my time. It's such a precious commodity, and I always vowed I would never lose the control of my own time. And with all these things we've been doing, I've achieved that, and it's probably the proudest thing I have is that I am in control of my time, so that I can do the things that I want to do, but also enjoy my life.
So you found the right place in the food industry, even after you thought you were done with it.
Right.
What were the skills that you brought to this work?
I have the ability to lead and to make things happen. I have the ability to focus and inspire others. And just by this whole collaborative thing that I talked about, that's really how it happened. And then towards the late 90s, you know, food banks, everybody thinks of food banks as being places where people, you get old cans and boxes. And that's really what they were. We just dealt in dry product, not refrigerated or frozen, because you need a lot of infrastructure to be able to distribute perishable food. And so what was happening was that food wasn't growing, that those boxes and cans weren't growing. So, you know, necessity said, hey, we've got to come up with a new place to go. And through some connections, this collaboration, working with a food bank in Fresno, California, which is the largest produce producing county in the United States. The executive director there said, you know, Gary, I've got this packer and he wants to give me all these peaches and plums and nectarines, and all I can use is a few pallets, but he wants to give me truckloads. How do we do this? And literally just going and talking to this operation told us how to do it. And we started, as I say, in 2000, distributed 750,000 pounds of produce.
So it sounds like you started off and you have some great people skills. You recognize the need to collaborate. They recognized in you also some of your planning and logistics capabilities. How did it all evolve, and when did you feel like it was really the place that you were meant to be?
When I left my career and in food business at a food brokerage company and started working at a food bank, it was like the weight went off my shoulders, and I felt a huge sense of freedom and the ability to give back and to do the things that I wanted to. And I was able, within the framework of the people I was working with, they gave me the leeway to be able to do the things that I thought were value, and gave me the freedom. There was no controls. I became a participant within the organization. Even though I was only working part-time, I felt as though I was a full participant. When I first got to the food bank, as I mentioned, it was just this tiny little 10,000 square foot building. And one of the first things they did, they put me on the steering committee. We're going to build a new building. And I got put on the board, you know, so all of a sudden you're brought into the organization. And it was just a matter of I received the respect as if I was a full-time employee, and that was huge value to me because I was able to participate, and what I said people listened to after a while, and so I've been there for 14 years now.
Well, you've touched on a theme that was brought up a few times today during the day, and that is empowering people and giving people the flexibility and the freedom to use their skills to the fullest and actually lead projects. And sometimes that's difficult for organizational leaders who have been used to having their fingerprints over everything. Did you ever run into those kinds of challenges?
Obviously with individuals, yes. I had, as I say, I was elected on the board, and so I had a very strong, and I have a very strong relationship with the executive director, the person that leads the organization. And in fact, it's his 20th anniversary with the food bank next week. So I've been there 14 years, maybe 15. He's been there 20 years. And so we've been able to develop a very strong rapport.
Were there any, rude awakenings or, moments when you kind of scratched your head and said, what the hell am I doing here?
Not really. It kind of worked from the word go. I have to say, I had this office in Pleasanton that was sort of real fancy and a fountain outside. And all of a sudden, I'm in a trailer, It was never important to me. That was never an issue, and so it was not a problem.
Yeah.
In that thing. We had to go over to a bus repair yard to go to the bathroom. Until we got porta potties.
Yeah. So although you started as a volunteer, as a Vista volunteer, your position kind of grew into one where you're getting paid. Talk with us a little bit about what the value of money, the place of money in the exchange, obviously you're making even considerably less than what you once did. What's that whole thing with money, the symbolism of money meant in this transaction?
Yeah, I as a Vista volunteer, I was paid $700 a month. That was what you get paid for. After the year, the executive director and I talked and said, "We'd really like you to continue on working with the food bank. How much do you want us to pay you?" It was literally how the conversation went, and I thought it through, and. I think, like most of you, or all of you in this room, if you're gonna, you want to earn what you do. And so I said, I want to earn $2,000 a month. That way, I know that I've got the freedom. If I want to go to Europe every year, I want to do the things I want to do. But I'm earning less enough that. It's not a problem, it's not an issue for it. And I worked for $2,000 a month for a number of years, and then I took on some additional responsibility, and I said, okay, so now I earn $3,000 a month. And I started this farm-to-family program, which is separate from what I do with the food bank, and I have not been paid for that one. That's just the labor of love that I do. But to answer your question, I think it qualifies you as part of the organization if you do earn something. And I do get my health. I'm part of the food bank health plan, and that's a value too. But I didn't. I should just say that. I didn't plan to do this. If my wife hadn't passed away, I would have continued to work, doing what I was doing. So I really didn't have any money set aside. But it's amazing how things can work out, and they have. So.
Mm-hmm. So tell us a little bit more about the creation of Farm to Family. I know we're going to see the video about the story, but share with us a little bit about how that whole thing got conceived.
Well, as I said earlier, I saw that we weren't getting enough. I'd love to say that the reason we did it was because we needed to get nutritious food to people in California. I'd love to say that. But the reality is that it was a need. They needed food, period. And it turned out that fresh produce was getting thrown away, and perfectly edible food, and hundreds and thousands and millions of pounds. And it's the product that that's perfectly edible, but when you see it in the supermarket, you wouldn't pick it up. It's got a little nick in it, you know, it's too big, too small, got a little whatever. And so that's the kind of product that we go after. And we go to growers and packers throughout the state. As I say, we started with stone fruit, which is absolutely the most fragile product that you could distribute. And you have to have an infrastructure where we pick it up. What we do is we give the packers these bins, and they fill them with their culls, which is this perfectly edible product. I'll use stone fruit, peaches, plums, and nectarines as an example. They hydrocool it, they put it in refrigeration for us, and then each week we send five trucks, and they load the five trucks, 44 bins a truck, and then those trucks then go to different routes, and then they go to Fresno, Modesto, Sacramento, etc. And then another route goes over to the coast, another route goes down into Southern California. So we're spreading this fresh produce throughout the state in a very organized way, and then each food bank is receiving only the amount of product that they need, because we have tiny food banks. You know, small food banks could only use a couple of bins, a couple of pallets, where we've got large organizations like the Los Angeles Food Bank or San Francisco, you can use full truckloads. So it was a matter of tailoring the program to the individual need of each food bank. And then the donors, people have recognized the value of what we do. And so even with this major recession we're having, we're seeing food banks being very well supported by the public. And with this fresh produce, and as I say, a lot of food banks, over 50% of everything they distribute is fresh now. It's a real value to the whole community. Mm-hmm.
So tell us about the Purpose Prize and the process of being nominated and receiving it and what you did with that prize.
Yeah, well, it's, you know, that's not what you get into what you do. That was not the reason I was doing it. And my wife said, you know, we're going to put you up for this, and written, and then interviews, and finally the recognition. And it's wonderful to get recognition, you know, to be able to come here and have people be able to tell my story and have people want to listen, you know. So, well, that was everybody's dream, isn't it? So that's what happened, and it's designed for people over 60. You got to be over 60, and Sidney Poitier came and kissed my mouth. So it's incredibly, and some of what people are doing is incredible.
Well, they are incredible. Suzanne Flint and I had a chance to attend this past year's Purpose Prize mm-hmm. event, and we were very inspired by the stories of so many people like yourself. You're very modest when you say, you know, that it wasn't obviously what you were looking for, and even now have a hard time kind of describing how significant it is. But you shared with me at dinner that you recently received another prize from your granddaughter. I thought maybe you could let people know what your granddaughter shared.
Well, I was in an event like this, and she's going to Lewis and Clark in Portland, and so I gave my pitch, and it was well received, and she came up to me afterwards and said, "Papa, I'm really proud of you." You know, and that makes it, doesn't it? I don't care. If your grandchildren or even your children say things like that, it really feels good. So, yeah. But again, that's not the reason why I'm doing it. And honestly, I'm going to keep working, just keep working until I, because it's a value to me personally. I mean, you get so much back by giving.
Yeah. Well, this is lesson time. So we've got a room full of library leaders who are scratching their head trying to come up with innovative ways that they can recruit people like yourself to come in and help them around planning and logistics and project management and any number of ways, talent recruiters. What are some of the lessons that you've learned and what has kind of appealed to you in your experience that would be tips you could give them about how they might go about that?
I've touched on a lot of it. I think making a person really feel as though they're part of the organization, I think that's really so valuable. To listen to what that person's saying, to have the connection, to, as I say, make them feel very much part of the organization. And that's what happened to me. So you asked, you know, what the hell am I doing here? I never had that experience because I didn't have people questioning what I was doing. I was given free rein. I was able to be creative, entrepreneurial, do the things that I wanted to do. And we went up a lot of wrong paths. But eventually, you have done some things of real value.
Mm. Yeah, great.
And I have to tell a story of I've had been able to mentor people into volunteering, and I have a very good friend right now, and it's very appropriate that he ran a major business, and it was you know this when the opera opens and when the symphony, etc., the people that do all the food.
Okay.
And I mean, literally, when Oracle came to town, they were doing 50,000 sushis. I mean, that much work. And so he retired. And it's just been really wonderful working with him. And he was going to sail around the world, and that didn't quite work out. And he was going to do this, and then he's going to do that. And now we're at the point where he's talking about, you know, maybe I can use the skill that I have to teach people how to cook and how they, you know, we get a lot of product that, you know, people don't know how to use. Winter squash, eggplant, chard, I can go on and on. You know, how, what do you do with that stuff? We get it donated. We got it distributed. You need him here right now. Yeah, I know. But I can see the light bulb going on in his head that he says, maybe I can do this. And really, so yes, when was it? Yesterday he was out looking at some pantries that we have, just seeing how we do it. And it's just a really, see a person get drawn in to and see the value that they can give back. It's very, very rewarding. Mm-hmm. And so tomorrow we're going to meet at the food bank and we're going to talk some more. But the key, one of the keys is, of course, is it's a commitment on both sides. It's a commitment for the food bank because, you know, we're going to invest in, you know, I'm going to turn him over to one of our really good people from the programs department, which is another thing that I really love about working with I love working with young people. We have so many young, enthusiastic people at the food bank. It's just terrific. It just invigorates you. So we meet with one of these young folks tomorrow, and I just see him kind of, yeah, this is something I want to do. And I think you're making a really great contribution.
So any of you thinking cooking programs is... we may have a candidate.
Yes.
In Marin, I think you may have a candidate here, so be thinking. Well, before we take a look at the video that you brought, I think I know the answer to this question, but because you said that you see yourself continuing to do what you're doing for as long as you can. But are there any other things on your bucket list as far as the world of work, the world of service?
Well, I think, yes, there are a lot of things that we want to do. I mean, within the food banking world,
mm-hmm.
and there's a number of things, great opportunities that I think we can pull off. I say this thing that my friend, I think, will take on, has great application across the state, teaching people how to cook or how to use some of these hard-to-use products. I think that's a great project. Actually purchasing product, food banks now purchase a lot of product, and we need to purchase it in the most economical way. We don't do a good job in that. This whole collaboration thing is so important, and for so many years, we didn't have that, and we're starting to see that break down. And a lot of it is created by this whole produce thing, because they have to share. They can't take a full truckload, mm-hmm. so they have to take part. That means they have to work with somebody else, which adds a lot of mm-hmm. value to everybody.
Yeah. Well, I'm going to ask Carla to cue up the video.
California leads the way in the nation's agriculture. We produce millions of tons of specialty crops each year, and the climate in much of California allows us to grow crops year-round. In reality, we have an overabundance of produce. As growers and packers, this excess becomes our cull product. What we do with that product can have a huge impact on our business, both present and future.
As a farmer, we grow food so people will eat it. You don't grow it to throw it away, so there's constantly a chance for some surplus products, whether they're not quite up to grade, number two products, that you can't get into the regular market supply. So that all by itself is always going to be a wonderful source where growers across the country, across our state, can plug in and work with food banks with surplus products.
Roughly 20 to 50% of our product that we grow out in the fields, unfortunately, is what we consider unmarketable. And usually it's slight blemishes that aren't considered acceptable by our retailers.
What Farm to Family is able to do is help bring these farm fresh products to the needy, to those who could use an improved diet, whether it's in the inner cities or whether it's throughout the state.
When food banks started, they relied primarily on donations of non-perishable food items, canned and packaged items. And it's really been within the last 5 years that we've been focusing on, especially nutritional needs and the importance of getting fresh fruits and vegetables to those who need it.
A good farmer will always take care of every single plant they plant. And what we see is when kids on a daily basis have a lousy diet, and day after day, when you are shortchanged as a living organism, whether it's a bean plant or a child, that has enormous consequences. I see it in my field, and that's where you start asking the question, what are we thinking? That we don't invest in our kids, our most valuable resource, as they're growing. They need to have that same package of good nutrients if you're going to guarantee they can reach their full potential as adults.
We've seen the shift towards more of a working poor, and what it means is that working hard no longer is a guarantee that you're going to be able to afford even life's most basics like rent, food, and transportation. We've also seen an increase in the last few years of senior citizens. Every time I go out to a pantry and I talk to clients, usually they say to me, this is the stuff that I can't afford. And they're talking about the fresh produce. So if you're on a very limited budget, you know that you need the fresh produce, but you don't necessarily have the resources to get it.
It means a lot, because then I can add, you know, when we're short on funds and we can't do all the shopping we'd like to, if we can come and get this free food, it means more healthy foods for my kids.
There are so many ways a grower can participate with the Farm to Family program, and certainly one is they can donate products into the Farm to Family program, but another one is they can work with Farm to Family and be compensated for some of the costs of production, and that makes it easier then for some growers who haven't had a chance to see how this partnership works to work, because ultimately Farm to Family becomes another one of your customers.
The California Association of Food Banks runs the Farm to Family program and has had the responsibility for growing this program so rapidly over these past few years. and shepherding its growth in these next few years.
The Farm to Family program links farmers around the state with both urban and rural communities and facilitates the process from the farm to the consumer.
You know, this is our third year with Farm to Family, and I've enjoyed working with the personnel there. They've been very good to work with. They always seem to have a home where the product goes. We're going to grow this, and we know there's many out there that need it, that are unemployed right now, that are on low income, and that there's a place for it. And it was something that I felt we always had to do.
We do incur some costs, cold storage, power to cool, forklift drivers, all of these things cost money. So Farm to Family costs us approximately $8 per ton. But in the long run, the rewards are much more than that.
Farm to Family tries to make the whole process seamless. We're not going in with a small pickup and waiting for product for a farmer to give it to us. We supply bins and boxes for them to pack the product in. We supply contract trucking, and we pick it up when they ask us and deliver it efficiently and effectively so there's not a waste.
They show up on time, and they're very, very precise in how much product they can take.
From a business perspective, we do feel that there is a future return for us when we get good quality produce in the hands of the youth, and they have a good eating experience. We feel that we're cultivating future consumers of our product.
And a lot of our packers and growers have done market research that says that the people we serve eat apples, oranges, bananas, but maybe they don't know what a peach is. And what better way to introduce a young person to a healthy, nutritious peach than through Farm to Family?
Studies have shown that when children are introduced to new foods at a young age, they're more likely to develop those healthy eating habits that will last into, you know, their adulthood.
I didn't know what it was because it has a funny name, and I didn't like eggplant, but my mom made us try it, but it's pretty good now. She puts it in like two things.
Ending hunger is not just providing people enough calories to make it through the day. We want to be able to provide them with healthy and nutritious food that truly will improve their lives.
It does hurt to see all this fruit go to waste when we do see, even in our community, the working poor, some of the kids go hungry when we have this good quality produce that is unmarketable for a slight blemish. It pains us to see that.
Me and my family have been granted so much, and we know there's needy all around us that don't live near as well as we do. It's part of the duty that I feel that we need to do is give back to those that are in need.
As a secretary, but also as a grower, once you get started with Farm to Family, you see the great value, the great contribution you can make, and I encourage any and all growers to try and look for that handhold with Farm to Families as they come into your area. The ones that are already doing it, I thank them tremendously for their willingness to be a part of the betterment of a community.
To learn more about how you can contribute to food banks in rural and urban California, contact the California Association of Food Banks at 510-272-4435.